I'll say, I'll remind them about the translation.
Yes, so they can get their headphones. Yes.
Oh, and I have to say it in Spanish.
Yes.
Just so you know, Juan fell this past week, and so he's having trouble with his eyes just focusing. We're going to go see a neurologist,
okay.
But if he cannot read it, mm-hmm. could you come and help?
Sure. So I'll be right there so he can
okay. sit down there.
Just a quick reminder for everyone to silence your phones again after lunch, and thank you very much for being considerate.
Welcome, everyone, to the second half of our program this afternoon. We will be talking today about the mapping, the development of Cuban art in Miami, private consumption, public circulation. Before we go into the panel, I wanted to remind everyone about the program this evening at 7 p.m. It'll be the first of two artist panels where the Cuban American artists who went to Cuba last year will be in conversation with the Cuban artists who are visiting from Havana this week. So that's tonight at 7. And tomorrow, our program continues from 11 to 12:30. We'll have the four curators who are visiting us from Havana in a panel. That panel will be in Spanish, and so will the second artist panel tomorrow afternoon from 2:30 to 4:30. Now, we do have simultaneous translation, so tomorrow, for those who don't speak Spanish, you'll be able to get headphones. Para las personas esta tarde que no hablan inglés y prefieren escuchar el panel en español, hay audífonos disponibles para que ustedes puedan escuchar todo lo del panel esta tarde. I'd like to introduce our moderator today. Dr. Juan Martínez is Professor Emeritus in the Department of Art and Art History at the Florida International University in Miami. Professor Martínez is an art historian who taught courses in European and Cuban modern art. He is the author of the seminal book, Cuban Art and National Identity, The Vanguardia Painters, 1927 to 1950, from University of Florida Press, that's 1994. Carlos Enriquez, the painter of Cuban ballads, Miami, Cernuda Arte, 2010. And Maria Brito, who's a Cuban-American artist based in Miami, from 2009. He has also published numerous books, book chapters, and essays in exhibition catalogs. His latest curatorial work is Cuban Art and Identity, 1900 through 1950, presented at the Vero Beach Museum in 2013-2014. His most recent essay is The Miami Generation, 1983 to 2013, for an exhibition at the Museum of Art Fort Lauderdale titled The Miami Generation Revisited. That was in 2014. He's currently writing a monograph on one of the pioneers of Cuban modern painting, Fidelio Ponce de León. Juan.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you, Elizabeth, for inviting me to moderate this panel, for putting together this panel and this whole conference. Major job. And of course, thanks to PAMM for hosting this conference that doesn't come often. So this afternoon, this panel is concerned with the circulation and reception of contemporary Cuban art in the last 30-some years, particularly as it relates to Miami. As you all know, once a work of art is finished, then it begins a whole life. The artists themselves sometimes, curators, gallery directors, galleries, museum, temporary exhibitions, biennials, art fairs, and so on, have to do with the art coming to the public and the circulation of the works of art. Once the work of art is out there, then comes the reception. The public at large, people like yourselves, our critics, are commentators, all have to do, collectors, very important, they put their money in it. They all have to do with the reception of the work of art, obviously, which is very important. And eventually in time, then our historians get into the game and museum acquisitions, and then it comes into the historical record, if you will. Posterity. This one Cuban artist that I've been writing about, Fidelio Ponce de León, used to say, the eyes of posterity are very, very small, you know? And also, to quote another artist, I fully agree with Marcel Duchamp, who said that the artist is responsible for 50% of the making of the work of art. The other 50% is the public. It takes a life of its own, and depends how it's received, that life continues or it doesn't. Today here we have a panel of experts, individuals that for the last 30 years or more, actually, have been collecting art. In the case of two of them, have also been related to the marketing of Cuban contemporary art. And they're going to speak of their experience. And hopefully some of the themes that we'll touch upon are the evolution of the marketing and collecting of Cuban art here in Miami in the last three decades or so. We'll also hopefully address the fact of who are these Cuban artists that we're speaking of. Because in the case of Miami, you have different groups. You have the group of Cuban Americans who emerged in the late 70s and 80s in the city. You have the Mariel generation. You have the Cuba's 1980s generation, both the one that emerged at the beginning and at the end of the decade, many of whom came to live here in Miami and still do and work here. And then you have the people, the Cubans have arrived here post-2000, some of them to live, some of them passing through, but in all cases exhibiting and selling works of art in here. So there are all these specific groups that perhaps also can be alluded to in some detail. And then there are other issues that we might touch upon, such as the preference or prejudices about collecting Cuban art by people who live in Cuba as opposed to people who live abroad. So there's a multitude of issues that obviously we cannot cover all in one afternoon, but we'll do the best we can, okay? And so without any more ado, to sort of cut to the chase, I will introduce the panelists. Each will have 15 minutes, and afterwards, hopefully, we have time for questions from the audience, okay? So the first panelist that will speak is Ramón Cernuda. Ramón Cernuda is a book publisher and producer, art collector, Cuban Museum Board of Directors officer, and vice president of that institution, and is the director of Cernuda Arte. He's a co-founder and producer of the Cuban Encyclopedia, the Martí Encyclopedia, Inglés Ahora, and various books and self-studies audiovisual programs. He's also recently published the book that was mentioned earlier, Carlos Enriquez, the Painter of Cuban Ballads, and he's also working on a publication of another book, this time by Fidelio Ponce, a Cuban original. He's a Cuban collector since 1973. The Cernuda family collection encompasses artworks from the colonial and early 20th century traditional Cuban art, Vanguardia and the School of Havana artists, the Cuban modernists, and a selection of established contemporary artists from the diaspora, Cuban and the diaspora. Cuban Museum of Art and Culture Board of Directors, officer, chair of the Programs Committee and Vice President of the institution from 81 to 96. He's currently the director of Cernuda Arte, as I mentioned before, commercial gallery that specializes in Cuban art and opened in 1999. Ramón, please. Yes.
Well, thank you very much, Juan. Thank you for that introduction. And thank you, Elizabeth, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. I also want to thank the PAMM. I especially want to thank Jorge Perez and all the other sponsors who've made this seminar possible. And most of all, I want to thank all of you for being here. I feel like a little bit like what Andy Warhol promised in 1968 in Sweden. He said that every one of us should have 15 minutes of fame. I think that these are going to be my 15 minutes. Thank you very much. Cuban art in Miami, past, present, and future, 50 years in 15 minutes. Let us begin this conversation going back to the 1960s. The first waves of Cuban exiles from the island brought with us the cultural values and traditions that defined our identity: language, history, religion, culinary practices, music, literature, and certainly the love for the art of our country. In the early 1960s, the political strives and the struggle for survival occupied most of the time and energy of that growing traditional exile community. By the end of the decade, when it was evident that the return to the motherland would not be immediate, the Cuban exiles entrenched inside their values, culture, and traditions, preparing themselves for the long wait. The first exhibitions of Cuban art in the late 1960s and early 1970s in Miami were held at the Bacardi Art Gallery, founded in 1964. There, the revered vanguardia artists, especially the first and second generation, and others who had arrived in the early days of the exile life, exhibited their works. They were presented mostly in group shows, many curated by Vera Wilson, under the guidance from a distance of art critic and museum director at the OAS, José Gómez Sicre. Cuban art in Miami had found its foothold thanks in good part to the support of the Bacardi organization. In 1977, Marta Gutierrez, Dora Valdez Fauli, with the assistance of art historian and artist Cesar Trasovares, formed and ran Forma Gallery, the first Latin American commercial gallery in Miami. Shortly afterwards, Meeting Point, another gallery, was formed. Art critics in the Nuevo Herald, such as Rafael Casalins and Norma Niurka, from the pages of that newspaper, gave recognition and a measure of journalistic credence to art exhibits, which featured, again, works from deceased Cuban artists from the past, Cuban exile artists, and younger Cuban-American artists who had just recently started their development. No artists living in Cuba were presented in these exhibitions in those days. In October 1982, the Cuban Museum of Arts and Culture was founded in Little Havana. It immediately became the new epicenter for Cuban art in the city. Thousands attended the museum events, and the collector base for Cuban art continued to grow. In 1984, Sotheby's Latin America Art Auction first held an event in Miami promoting its offerings here in this city, under the guidance of art historian and friend Julio Blanc, and also the enthusiast support of collector Dolores Smithies. Not long afterwards, the Art Miami Fair was established and quickly became a venue for the exhibition and marketing of the accepted Cuban and Cuban-American art in Miami. As the market grew, the art community became more numerous and plural. The prevailing norms that had ordained the local art scene began to be questioned by younger attendants and participants. And it also began to be defied. The unwritten dictum that prohibited the local exhibition of works by Cuban artists from the island was first shattered in 1988 with the inclusion of a painting by artist Manuel Mendive in the show at the Cuban Museum of the City. All hell broke loose. The disruption of the policies of censorship provoked a major social upheaval in the community. Debate, controversy, accusations of treason, violence, physical aggressions, acts of terrorism, and even governmental persecution ensued. It was a dark moment for Cuban art in Miami. Nosotros también tuvimos nuestro quinquenio gris. Fortunately, the U.S. federal courts sided with the cause of freedom of expression and artistic freedom. The judicial decision, Cernuda versus the U.S. government, case number 89-1265 from September 1989, opened up the roads and cleared the way for legal, unobstructed arrival of Cuban art from the island to the United States of America. That day, it was ruled that the embargo laws could not be applied to the arts, not only Cuban art, but in those days, art from Vietnam, Korea, Libya, and other countries was also being embargoed. Under this new legal framework, slowly but surely, modern and contemporary Cuban art began to flourish. The people-to-people policies of the Clinton administration facilitated that Cuban artists, not only their artworks, could come to the United States. In the year 2000, our gallery promoted and popularized in Miami one-person art shows of Cuban island artists who were awarded U.S. entry visas upon our letters of invitations to attend the openings of their exhibits. Alfredo Sosa Bravo, Flora Fong, Miguel Florido, Roberto Diago, Ania Toledo, Vicente Hernandez, and others participated in these groundbreaking movements and also had to confront very scandalous and provocative manifestations of opposition. The George W. Bush years up to 2008 brought about a return to the days of disconnect. Visas for Cuban artists were again nearly impossible to obtain. The importation of artworks and payment to artists required so much bureaucratic paperwork, inspections, and licenses that all but a few galleries gave up. You could not really survive without a specialized law firm assisting you. As everyone now knows, there was light at the end of that tunnel. And the current redefinition of the bilateral relations between the two countries has opened up avenues of contacts, visits, cultural exchanges, and potential growth for Cuban art in this city and in the whole of the United States. Let us talk a little bit about the present. The United States population acquired $27.3 billion in artwork in the year 2015 alone, according to the annual art market report produced by the European Fine Art Foundation. This figure represents 43% of all global sales of art. Imagine 5% of the population of the world acquires almost half of the yearly art sales, making the U.S. the number one country in art acquisitions in the world, surpassing the statistics of number two, England, and number three, China, together. The U.S. art market is the only major market in the world that actually grew in 2015 at a rate of 4% with regards to the prior year. One interesting occurrence in the U.S. during 2015 has been this past year's focus on Cuban art by U.S. critics, curators, journalists, and collectors. Undoubtedly, there has been an extraordinary attention placed on Cuban art by the U.S. press. 7 articles in the New York Times, 5 articles in the Wall Street Journal, 3 articles each in the Chicago Tribune and the Washington Post, plus at least 1 article each in Forbes magazine, Times magazine, Architectural Digest, the Huffington Post, Art News, and Art and Auction, all in 1 year, all laudatory. In spite of these enormous, encouraging barrage of positive publicity, the overall sales of Cuban art in the United States are only a minimal fraction of the art sold in this country. Recent studies conducted by our galleries and others, based on auction sales reports and reported sales transactions by major galleries, and presented to the Appraisals Association of America in New York this past May, calculate the total Cuban art sales in the US for the year 2015 to be in the neighborhood of $40 million for that year. This signifies a 40% jump from 2014 of Cuban art sales in the US, with expectations for an even better 2016. Notwithstanding these advances for Cuban art in the US, our share of the total pie in the US is a meager 0.14% of the total US market, the equivalent of 14 cents for every $100 of sales. We have a long way to go before Cuban art can be considered a significant player in the international arena of modern and contemporary art. Going forward, what needs to be done for Cuban art to reach the level of market valuation that it deserves? There are many, many, many answers to that question, and I only have 15 minutes plus 2 minutes that my friend Snitzer gave
Salty.
Me. Thank you. He did not put a price to them, but I'm sure I'm going to get a bill. Allow me my opinion about what next could be done to advance the cause of Cuban art in this market, the United States, and in general. Virtually all successful U.S. artists work within commercial gallery structures. They respect the commercial gallery, and they work and honor their commitments to their galleries, and they refrain from directly selling themselves, their productions, to collectors. Commercial galleries are the wheels that move the international art market. That's why he gave me the 2 minutes. They are the entities that promote the artist, that nourish the artist when necessary, that exhibit artists' creations under the most appropriate settings, that feature the art in art fairs and connect the artists to journalists and curators. They, the galleries, place the artworks in distinguished collections and into museum exhibitions. The equation is clear and simple. Artists create, gallerists market and promote. There is virtually no path to commercial market success in the first world outside of the gallery system. Cuban artists have already started to develop stable business relations with US galleries and also with European and other international galleries. This is good and promising. It needs to be continued. Artists in Cuba also should demand and obtain the legalization of private commercial galleries inside the country. As you all know, there are no professional private Cuban-owned, independent, and free-to-choose galleries in the island. All Cuban galleries are government-owned, government-run, and/or subject to the cultural and political wishes of the Ministry of Culture. Cuba and North Korea are the only two countries in the world that by law do not allow their citizens the private ownership of art galleries. It is simply illegal. There are artist studios where a specific artist is allowed to present his or her works to visitors. There are some groups of artists that work together, but a commercial gallery as defined, an entity that publishes catalogs, an entity that rents space, that advertises nationally and internationally, that attends international art fairs, that sends invitations, hold meetings, events, and all other kinds of promotional materials, that does not exist. Yes, there are some illegal, discreetly managed and barely tolerated spaces in apartments, in private homes, where art is quietly presented as the owners of these locales attempt to circumvent the law. Under such semi-clandestine behavior, nothing can really prosper. For contemporary art to expand, this must change. Too many talented artists are being ignored or disregarded by government officials, and out of frustration, they leave the country or abandon their artistic calling. It is a sad spectacle. Cubans should be allowed to own and operate private art galleries, and international galleries should also be allowed to establish themselves in Cuba. These well-financed and prestigious international galleries would play a decisive role in connecting Cuban artists with the international, modern, and contemporary markets. This measure alone, the legalization of private art galleries, would have enormous impact on Cuban art, as did the legalized privatization of restaurants and cafeterias in Cuba just a few years ago. In short, governments are not good at making sandwiches or selling art. In conclusion, Cuban art in Miami and in the United States has had a 55-year trajectory affected by the conflictive nature of the bilateral relations between the two countries. As U.S. policy towards Cuba has recently changed, the art market has responded favorably, and Cuban art sales are quickly growing in the United States. The future for the Cuban art industry will depend, in good measure, on the decisions of the Cubans regarding the legal reforms that are necessary in this industry. Privatization of art galleries, and also, by the way, of art supply stores. Every time a friend, an artist friend from Cuba arrives, the first thing they want to know is where's a supply store for art. That would do much good for Cuban art and allow it to reach its next level of success and recognition. Thank you.
No, perfect. Que no te cobre por más de dos minutos. Okay, next, Frederick Snitzer. Born in Philadelphia in 1950, he studied art at Philadelphia College of Art, where he received a BFA in sculpture, and the Pennsylvania State University, where he received an MFA in sculpture. He moved to Miami in 1977 and opened the gallery Frederick Snitzer. He has been an adjunct faculty member of New World School of the Arts for the past 22 years, teaching sculpture, freshman foundations, and a senior seminar in the college. He has exhibited his own work frequently over the last 38 years, most recently at the New World School of the Arts and Mindy Solomon Gallery. He will have a solo exhibition in the fall at the University of Florida. Member of the Art Dealers Association of America and the Art Basel Miami Beach Selection Committee for the last 15 years, the gallery and his artists have been covered in numerous national and international publications, The Wall Street Journal, Newsweek, The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, Le Monde, and International Herald Tribune. Frederick, please.
You owe me for more than 2 minutes. So I'm actually very happy that Ramón presented what he did, because it's mine is a much more kind of personal experience. I opened the gallery in 1977. I went to school in Philadelphia, and strangely enough, in Philadelphia in the late 60s, one of my professors gave me a book to read called History Will Absolve Me by Fidel Castro. And at the time, I was a good Jewish hippie from Philadelphia, and all this stuff was very interesting to me, but really very foreign. So I came to Miami, and in 77, I opened the gallery. Is this gonna go? So I opened the gallery in 77, really not much of an intention to actually have a gallery. I wanted to do my work, teach, do some other things, and thought, well, I have to sell, make a living somehow, so I'll sell things. Really had no inclination towards being a gallery that would exclusively represent or represent Cuban artists, but I think in about 1980, I thought, well, you know, there's a large Cuban community here. Maybe I should try and look for some Cuban art and show it. So I got a hold of a portfolio of Wilfredo Lam, kind of not so good, not so interesting, but large edition, pretty commercial, but inexpensive group of Wilfredo Lam prints called Plenty Luna. And I thought, well, I'll have an exhibition, I'll advertise it, and I will embrace the Cuban community. We opened the exhibition, and by 8 o'clock, I had a phone call with a bomb threat. They're gonna bomb me, because didn't I know that this guy was a communist? And so the adventure with Miami and having a gallery and showing work began. And also my relationship with Cuban artists, the Cuban community. One of the interesting things that happened during that period of time were there were a lot of collectors who wanted to buy these prints but didn't want to do it in person. So they would send somebody else in to buy the prints and take them with them. So this was all very interesting to me and strange. And I proceeded. So a number of what I found in the time when I look back and for this talk, so many things that happened in my gallery were somehow or other a reflection of politics, human condition, culture. I really didn't think that happened in galleries in other places. I think in other places you represented an artist, you sold their paintings, but here we were totally immersed in politics and culture. So I'm gonna read to you a list of artists that over the 38 years that I've been in business, I've exhibited or represented that happened to be Cuban. I'll read it quickly. Fernando Garcia, Adalberto, and I'll sort of point out some of them that not were better or worse artists or whatever, but were artists that sort of opened some doors for me in a particular direction. So Fernando Garcia, Adalberto Delgado, Fernando and Adalberto had an exhibition with me early on, and they sort of opened the door for me to the Cuban artist community. Jose Bernardo, Wilfredo Lam, Rafael Soriano, Luis Cruz Azaceta. I'll tell you what year it was. There was an exhibition at the Center for Fine Arts, which is what this used to be, called Art of the Fantastic. And Art of the Fantastic was a survey of Latin American art, and also pretty controversial in a variety of ways. There was text in the catalog that some people in the community didn't like or felt was didn't put Cuba and Cuban artists in the right light. At any rate, I went to that exhibition with Adalberto Delgado, and we walked through the exhibition, and I saw the work of Luis Cruz Azaceta and Jose Beria, and I went out of my mind. I just thought it was spectacular work. I didn't know who these artists were, And so this began an interest for me in how could I get these artists, what could I do? I'll show you the Aceseta. So in the case of Aceseta, pretty difficult work, not particularly commercially appealing, easy to sell, but I just thought he was a spectacular artist. I'll continue with my list. Ruben Torres Yorca, Paul Sierra, Julio Antonio, Juan Abreu, Emilio Perez, Christian Curiello, Baru Salinas, Ramon Alejandro, Arturo Cuenca, Quisquea Enriquez, Adriano Burgos, Ana Albertina Delgado, Consuelo Castañeda, Dania Del Sol, Victor Gomez, Alberto Torre de Alba, Florencio Helabert, Jose Beria. That was a pivotal moment for me. Jose and I had been in Cuba and was deciding whether or not to leave Cuba. We had talked many times about having an exhibition and both sort of agreed that having an exhibition when he was still in Cuba wouldn't do really either one of us much good. There would be a tremendous amount of problems with that. He finally left Cuba and we had an exhibition with him. That exhibition changed the life of my gallery and of me. I will tell you that, in my opinion, galleries don't make artists, artists make galleries, for sure. I lived it. So I'll continue. Tomás Sesson, Carlos Cárdenas, Humberto Calzada, Juan Abreu, Ernesto Pujol, Maria Martinez Cañas, Luis Gispert, Bert Rodriguez, Leiden Rodriguez Casanova, Mauricio Gonzalez, Manny Perez, Hernan Bas was another pivotal moment. This is a Cuban-American from Miami. I began to show him when he was 19 years old. And he's gone on to have this spectacular international career. Rafael Dominic, Enrique Martinez Celaya. I now work with the remainder of, really can't call it the estate, but the remainder of available work from Carlos Alfonso. And happily also represent Alex Arechea. So those are the lists of artists. I'll just kind of briefly go through some more of my history. This is Luis Cruz Aceseta. So he was the first exhibition that I did. Actually, he's the first exhibition that I did with a solo artist. Before that, I hadn't really even been in a financial position to represent artists singly. So I had this exhibition with him. And soon after that, there was many, many artists for a long time had done paintings, works on paper, lithographs about the balseros, about the rafters. In those days, there were 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 rafters a summer coming ashore in Miami. So my friend Adalberto Delgado did a documentary with Jorge Alea. And the documentary took place in a funeral for a Cuban rafter. We also had a friend who had made a deal with the Coast Guard and was collecting the rafts that would come ashore in those days, and there were tons of them. So I decided to have an exhibition of the rafts and the paintings and to also show this documentary. So these are the rafts, and each raft has a story. That white raft there was the royal raft because the QE2 had passed through on its way somewhere, and they saw this little thing bobbing in the ocean, and it was a guy. This was a styrofoam container for a Russian chandelier, and he had gotten a hold of it, dug it out, and used it to escape Cuba, and was picked up by the QE2. And that guy was also at our opening, which was pretty amazing. What I thought was remarkable about these was that I thought that they had this aesthetic resonance to them, that they weren't obviously built with any intention of being looked at. They were extremely utilitarian. But somehow or other, what was invested in them was some remarkable power, and each one of them had successfully gotten somebody here. So that was that exhibition, and it got a lot of international coverage. Then came a group of artists. This is Tomás Sesson. And there was a group of artists that came next, after Beria, Carlos Cárdenas, Tomás Sesson, Arturo Cuenca, Quisquea Enriquez, and Consuelo Castañeda. Very, very difficult, very aggressive work. This work, I can vividly remember this. We used to have slides in those days. And I remember this sweet little couple wanting to see what work was available by Tomas, and I showed them this thing, and they didn't buy it, but they were at least considered it, which is pretty amazing. So that led me to something else. So these artists had arrived, and they were very interesting, and so I decided to publish a portfolio of prints. I used a Japanese printmaker in New York who had been printing for Sala Witt and a number of other really terrific artists, and I commissioned with a friend of mine, Gary Michaels, this portfolio called Five. It was Julio Antonio, Tomás Asson, Luis Cruz Azaceta, Juan Abreu, and Carlos Cardenas. The remarkable thing about this was that, I'm going to go back because I have the list here, there are like 25 museums that this portfolio was accepted into. The first museum where it was accepted was the Whitney Museum of American Art. And the Whitney Museum of American Art had a big question about what that meant to take in these five Cubans. We did it, and we got it in, and we got it into a number. The Hirshhorn, there's a whole group of museums that this portfolio was in. So back to, again, the evolution of things. Jose Beria was a huge, these slides are very close to being the same, but a huge, pivotal, important artist for me that brought other artists to the gallery. He is an extremely important artist. That is a raft, actually. That this is part of the Rebel family collection, and that's again a raft that was found on the shores and retrieved and was part of this installation. Further on, I represented and still do Maria Martinez Cañas. And most recently, Rafael Dominic, young artist. I have to tell you that at no time, and this might sound ridiculous after that long list, did I ever decide that I wanted to have a gallery and represent Cuban artists. I don't want to have a gallery that represents women or Jews or Cubans or anything else. It happened that at every point along the way, I represented these artists because I'm opportunistic and because these were great artists. That was it. And there's some Alex Arechea. I'll leave you last with just one comment because I know that we were supposed to talk about a little bit about the market and the impact of the market. And many of the things that I think Cuban artists are up against, all artists are up against. The market is a very, very difficult and complicated thing for artists. Perhaps more complicated depending on the culture that you were raised in, but the first time an artist produces a body of work, it's all flowers, they have an exhibition, all the flowers sell out. They go back to their studio, there's now a waiting list for flowers. What am I gonna paint? Well, I have to feed my family, I have this waiting list for flowers. That's the dilemma of the artist. That's the problem, that's the oppression of the market. And like, again, it is worse in many ways for artists. I remember artists when they first got here would tell me, you know, I got this thing in the mail and it looks like I won $250,000 with the publisher's clearinghouse. Or I owe taxes from this. The cultural issues are enormous. But beyond that, there are issues that all artists have to deal with in terms of the market. And again, the impression of it.
Thank you. Third, Howard Farber. Howard Farber is a collector of Cuban contemporary art, but here are a few of the many endeavors, of his many endeavors before he got there. He was a studio drummer in the early days of rock and roll, hanging out at the Brill Building, playing on many hit rock and roll classics of the 60s. Howard flew a plane, but only once. He crash on his first solo flight to another city and live to tell the story. After investing in Manhattan real estate for many years in the late 70s, he opened his first ever video store in the world. It was a precursor to the whole industry of home entertainment and grew to a chain of stores which was sold to RKO Studios. He was on the board of directors of Friends of American Art and the Vatican Museum in Rome for 5 years. He produced and distributed the videos of the World Wrestling Foundation. He had many good times wedged between giant wrestlers at dinners. What an image. He volunteered in his local New York City police precinct and became a licensed New York State peace officer. He and his team were responsible for pursuing over 200 cases of child abuse and child neglect. And throughout all of this, there was art collecting, American modernist, early 20th century photography, ancient artifacts, and a major collection of Chinese contemporary art. And now, Howard.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very happy to be here on this esteemed panel. I'd like you to know right away that I'm not a curator, I'm not a writer, and I'm not an artist. And you will see that I'm not a public speaker either. I am an art collector, a serial art collector. The early days. It was a happy accident that brought me to Cuban contemporary art. In 2001, my wife, Patricia, and I went on a cultural exchange trip to Cuba with the Metropolitan Museum. On that trip, we were taken to many different artist studios. I was very impressed with the works that I saw, but I did not buy anything. And the reason why I didn't buy anything is because I knew nothing about Cuban contemporary art. And before I buy any art, I like to do my research first. At the time, there were only very few books on Cuban contemporary art. One particular book stood out. It was called New Art from Cuba by Louis Chemnitzer. And it's an old book, but it became my Bible. I took it everywhere. Even today, I read it twice a year from cover to cover, and I take it on every vacation. And just in case I got bored, I brought it with me here today. In 2001, it was pretty difficult to go to Cuba with a group and buy art and have it shipped back, especially when you're going with a tour bus of 25 of your closest friends. So I bought nothing on the trip. Anyway, as fate would have it, when I returned back to the United States, I received an email from Cuba. And that was the first email I had ever received from Cuba. And I was very excited. I said, this is really sexy, to get an email from Cuba. It was from a man by the name of Abelardo Mena, who was a curator at the National Museo in Havana. He wanted information from me on Chinese contemporary art, which I was collecting at the time. Can you imagine? I have a curator from the National Museum wanting something about Chinese contemporary art, and I needed information on Cuban contemporary art. So I became his mentor, and he became my mentor as well. We are still friends, and he has been my curator to this day. A move to Miami soon revealed many fabulous, thriving Cuban artists living right here. It was heaven. I met them, and I bought works by them all. I want to show you some of the first works that I bought. The first artist is Jose Bedia. he likes Indians. Arturo Cuenca, Carlos Estevez, Gori, Consuelo Castaneda, Umberto Castro, the photographer Maito, Ruben Torres Yorca, my friend Gustavo Acosta, and Glexis Novoa. Now, I have always veered towards classic, older examples of an artist's work. I like provenance, I like historical content, and sometimes very dark and tough images. Carlos Cardenas. You gotta look at their plate. Juan Pablo Ballester. And the one for the dining room, Tomas Esson. Now, I often hear collectors say that they only buy works they love. This is not true for me, as you can see. I sometimes buy a work I don't love if I feel it belongs in the context of my collection. In 2007, I was asked to do a solo traveling museum show of the collection, and I said yes without hesitation. The show was called Cuba Avant-Garde, and when I saw it mounted for the first time, I realized something very profound. The artists in the Farber collection lived everywhere in the world, but the art was about Cuba. And then a theme emerged. The artwork spoke of a time and a place in Cuba, of the people who lived and loved and struggled there. It was very moving to me and very powerful. And it started me thinking once again of a next move. By 2099, nothing much had happened to the Cuban contemporary market. I thought it was languishing. It seemed to me that the politics of the two countries, the United States and Cuba, had a stranglehold on its arts. You know that many people from Cuba could not get permission to come and view their own shows here, and vice versa. My wife and I felt very deeply that it was time to do more to spread the word. We formed the foundation whose mission was to create worldwide awareness of Cuban contemporary art, basically to broaden the reach. So it started with a foundation, and it started with grants. And we gave grants to artists. We did a residency for an artist, Eduardo Hernandez. Musicians, we sent Arturo O'Farrell's Latin Jazz Orchestra to Havana. And we sent some New York City ballet dancers so they can perform at a festival. We gave a grant to Karina Matamoros so she can finish a book on Raul Martinez. And the best thing that I liked was we helped finance the movie, Unfinished Spaces, an award-winning documentary, by the way. It's the story about ISA. It's the unfinished masterpiece art school in the middle of Havana. And the three architects that built it. By the way, it's on Netflix if you want to watch it. It's very good. Um, They say even the church has to ring the bell on Sunday. And ring the bell we did. Cuban Art News is an online publication which reports the news of Cuban art and culture from everywhere in the world to everywhere in the world. We report on visual arts, shows and events, auction news, dance, music, new publications, architecture, and even philanthropy. The need was there. Curators, gallerists, collectors, students, writers, and artists from everywhere made it their go-to reference to what's happening in Cuban cultural life. We are now in our seventh year of publication. And Cuban Art News has taken over 100% of the foundation's work and about 200% of its budget. We have editors in New York and Havana, and we have writers all over the world. We accept no advertising. We accept no donations. And as a result, Cuban Art News remains reader-friendly. We publish in English and in Spanish, and we are read in 177 countries. I find that amazing. And we take no political. Remember when Cuban Art News started placing Cuban art in an international art market context was already a politically radical position for a US foundation. For us, it's about the art and culture only. So now, our foundation and Cuban Art News has established more global recognition for Cuban contemporary art. In 2015, last May, it was time for us to ring that bell again, this time in the form of recognition, recognizing the artists themselves. The whole diaspora of contemporary Cuban artists globally. We chose 8 nominators and 8 jurors from on and off the island. And with great pride, the first international Cuban Art Awards were presented by an American foundation at the 2015 Havana Biennale. Some pictures. This is at the Wilfredo Lam Center, by the way. She's there. And he's there. The awards were covered on TV internationally and published in over 900 mainstream newspapers internationally. That's over 900 publications. Talk about recognition. This was as good as it was gonna get. The winning artists themselves, Alexandra Arachea, and newcomers Celia and Yunya, were already known to the world of Cuban art, but now their names became globally familiar to a new far-reaching audience. We are now planning our second International Cuban Art Awards. How great would that be to have the second awards presented right here in Miami? That's something I'm going to work on. Elizabeth Cerejido, I thank you for organizing this dialogue series. And Juan Martínez, thank you for your work with this series as well. And to all the sponsors of this dialogue series. It's symposiums like this that create awareness for a subject. We all know the political changes of the last year have had a positive effect on the Cuban market. There are more galleries, there's more press, there's more tourism, there's more museum exhibitions in the planning stages, and artists are getting major gallery representation, as the two gentlemen were talking about. Prices for the artworks are rising modestly. This is good. This is what we want to see. The modest rise of prices assures a realistic future to the market. I've seen art market bubbles, we all have, and we all know that eventually all bubbles will burst. The slow and steady as we want to see. In the meantime, I will continue to do my part spreading the word for Cuban contemporary art. I leave you with some images from the Farber collection. I'd like to call it dessert. Got to lose some weight. I enjoyed speaking with you today. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Howard. And now Peter Menéndez. Peter Menéndez has long been an advocate for the visual arts with a sustained trajectory of support and involvement with Miami artists and the city's visual art institutions. He has served on the boards of several community art organizations.
Thank you, Juan. Thank you, Liz. And thank you all of you out in the audience, because I'm a lousy speaker and I hate doing this, but I'm going to do it anyways because she asked me. It's going the wrong way. Okay. So I'm going to start with this. Can I go to the presenter's mode? Okay. What you're seeing here is a notebook I started about 40 years ago where I would keep records of art in and from Cuba. art for me was something only to be experienced in museum and gallery spaces. I can't pull this. Collecting was something people of means did. I was no more than an interested observer, and with my partner in the heady days of the 60s and early 70s, visited museums and galleries on a regular basis to look, to appreciate, to learn. One Christmas, feeling generous, I gifted my mate a small drawing similar to this one, which I found at the Florencio Garcia Cisneros Gallery on East 86th Street, a pioneering space that presented Cuban art in New York. Finished with architectural school but still living in Boston in 1979, I got this piece, something that I bought for myself, my first purchase. This came about only because a friend who had obtained it found that he had overstretched his budget and offered the work for me to get. While in Boston, I would often take Amtrak to Manhattan to visit galleries, one of which was Cayman Gallery, an early source for work by Latin American artists, including Cuban artists. From Boston, I moved back to New York, and in a short time, and through friends who had an interest on things relating to Cuba, met Ana Mendieta. She and I became part of a loose-knit group named Círculo de Cultura Cubana that met every so often for chats and discussions as a way to understand where we stood as Cubans and as Cuban-born Americans. Ana was the only one in that circle who had a connection to art, and naturally we gravitated to one another. In 1981, she visited Cuba to create work in an untamed area called Jaruco, where she carved her siluetas out of stone walls. The photographed works were exhibited at the AIA Gallery in Soho later in the year. I was her compinche in getting the exhibit up, participating as a sort of cog in the creative process. I helped her in every aspect of the hanging, from mounting the images to fresh painting the walls, designing a catalog, and documenting the opening with my trusted Nikkormat camera. In return for my assist, Ana gave me this drawing, nicknamed La Voladora, and daily bought a great lunch for us to share. It was an enriching experience, allowing me to begin to understand the trappings of pulling together an art exhibition. On her trip to Cuba, Ana had met a group of artists she got excited about at an exhibition called Volumen Uno. She encouraged me to take the trip to the island and discover for myself the new art being created there. Around this time, family pressure had me moving to Miami, and in the midst of this reshuffle, I managed to do the trip she suggested. In Havana, I met these young guys Ana had so been impressed with at the studio of Flavio Garciandia that he had at the house of Pichu, Menocal, y Villalón. That's Flavio at the time. Jose Bedia, also at that time, and Gustavo Perez Monzon at his Guanabo studio. Also Elso, Rodriguez Bray, and Ruben Torres Yorca as well I met. This piece by Torres Yorca, who my friend here owns, incorporates a photo by Rogelio Lopez Marin Gori of some of the artists in Volumen Uno during Ana Mendieta's visit. The Mariel boat lift was recent, and in our conversations, one name was mentioned as the only artist of any consequence that had left in that mass emigration, someone called Carlos Alfonso. Gori got me a phone number where I could reach him in Miami, and I did. With little delay, Alfonso and I started a deep friendship, and I became fully dedicated to him and his work, a total supporter and promoter lasting until his untimely passing in 1991. We talked about everything all the time, and I happily helped in any way he allowed, from creating and maintaining his archives to designing a couple of books on his work. This depicts us talking in earlier, simpler times. And here's the artist studio in South Beach, December of 1989. 10 years after meeting him, with him gone, I found myself looking for a house with ceilings high enough to accommodate this piece being returned from a Whitney Biennial, too big to fit in my apartment. The 80s were then, for me, the time when the idea of collecting took hold of my energies and motivation. I owned a handful of pieces by then and decided that moving on, I had to define a focus. Logic suggested it had to be one that reflected who I was, So by this definition, its core had to be Cuban American and Cuban art, and work created by living artists contemporary to my life. Limited by salary as only income meant searching for fairly young work and educating myself on what I could find out there. This approach to build a collection proved early on to be exciting, a true bonus for understanding how creative juices unfold over time, how fluidity in a career develops within the context and likely restraints of unforeseen forces. With a good eye for aesthetics, enhanced by the rigor of architectural school, and sharpened further by observation, I pursued collecting with passion, settling comfortably in the delight of meeting and hanging out with artists. Being a good listener by nature came in quite handy dealing with artists. Early on, I got the difference between personal and impersonal collecting, understanding this was not just about buying, but about establishing personal relations with artists. These interactions often could open doors to witness important works as they were being created. My collection, small as it is, was formed free of economic or social pressures. And as it grew, my target was depth rather than sample. The Cuba Museum of Arts and Culture in Miami had a well-received exhibit in 1983 named The Miami Generation. Curated by Julio Blanc, it featured a group of young Miami-based artists. This important exhibition became a kind of parallel in my head to Volumen Uno. Both were driven by the tenor of the times and the particularities of their individual contexts. Both had the energies and inspiration of a fresh batch of young creators looking for new ways of expressing themselves and challenging what had been done before. In 1985, Jose Bedia, whom I had seen again the year before at the first Havana Biennial, alerted me about being in a group show in New York. I made fast plans to come see new art from Cuba at sunny Old Westbury. These much-loved drawings, my earliest pieces by the artist, were part of that exhibition. On a trip to Havana for the second biennial in 1986, I met Maria Eugenia Aya Marucha and bought from her a suite of 13 evocative photographs, some shown here. Donated to PAMM some years ago, the museum has unfortunately never found a setting to highlight these treasures they now own.
You go, Peter.
In 1988, I came across Maria Martínez Cañas at her solo show at the Francis Wolfson Gallery. Fell in love with her work, and this is the first piece I got from her. And this is a subsequent acquisition, which for years now has been part of PAMM's permanent collection. In 1989, I saw the photo of a billboard in an art magazine, and it blew my mind. Was that art? Why did it grab me so strongly? Tried to find out about the artist, and to my amazement, discovered he was Cuban-American, raised in Puerto Rico. Sought him out. Found a way to send him a fan letter. With many shared commonalities, we became friends. I told him how much I would like to buy one of his pieces. A couple of years later, Felix suggested I go by his gallery in Soho and check out a work he thought I would love. Went. It was displayed behind the gallery director's desk, and she rather leisurely pointed towards it when I arrived. I bought it immediately. The gallery sent the piece to my office in a small box. Excited, called all my office buddies to come and share with me the moment of arrival of the first art piece purchased at a New York gallery. 10 guys surrounded me. I opened the box only to find a light bulb had shattered in transit. A discovery that the buds reacted too swiftly with a hearty roar. They regret it now. A period of intense activity in the Miami art scene began in the 90s. Opening with the unveiling of the public work by Oldenburg van Bruggen at Government Center, dropped bowl with scattered slices and peels. In 1991, Alfonso dies while in the midst of his strongest creative moment. The special period is happening in Cuba, and the mantle of AIDS is weighing heavy here. With many young artists suddenly going to live in Mexico, I took several exploratory trips there. One was to see an extraordinary exhibit, La Transparencia de Dios, or Por América, of the recently deceased Juan Francisco Elso at the Museo Carrillo Gil. A short time later, I got this piece. In September 1991, I heard about a gallery in Mexico having a show that featured Cuban artists. A couple of months later, the gallery Ninart did a follow-up exhibit that coupled Cuban and Cuban-American artists. This was something never attempted before, as far as I know. Early in the decade, Jose Bedia told me he was moving to Miami with his family. The Newsweek issue of 30 November 1992 took notice, declaring, "Here come the Cubans." The arrival of Cuban artists in the United States was underway. Themes previous generations of Cuban artists were mostly engaged with were the landscape, the elements creating a national identity, and or formalist concerns. These works they were doing reflected directly the singularities of their society. As artists, they were fully assuming responsibility with their time. Miami reverberated with these and other stimulating artists appearing on the scene. Their presence added to quickly altering dynamics going on in our city, bringing an unprecedented eagerness in the community with regards to the visual arts. This motivated established collectors and created new ones who began actively seeking out work one would not have imagined they would pursue before. Almost in tandem, but not necessarily related to that arrival, five public or private museums were being started or getting restructured. The art-invigorated community galvanized in supporting the efforts to host large events such as Art Miami initially and Art Basel Miami Beach afterwards. Around that time, I was invited to join, along with four other Cuban-American men, the board of trustees of the Center for the Fine Arts, a precursor to what became MAM and is now PAM. I remain on the board over 13 years, an active, fully committed participant. My collecting until then had remained somewhat private, continuing using the guidelines I had formulated from the beginning. At some point, my acquiring itch started to expand, and I began to include non-Cuban, Miami-based artists and African-American artists such as Kara Walker and Glenn Ligon, still concentrating on the initial stages of an artist's career. In time, I became more aware of the public role of a collector, and this resulted in an increase in donations to institutions. Encouraged by curators, here are some of the works I have donated to our host museum over the years. A friend cleverly advised me long ago that you only hold works of art temporarily, before they must move on. This installation piece was a joint gift made with the artist gallery. Recently, I have donated a couple of pieces to a much admired museum, the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis. My collecting days pretty much ended for practical reasons when I retired from my job in the architectural firm. And yet, 3 years ago, I met a young artist, Rafael Domenech, then a student at New York School of the Arts, at a school group exhibition during Art Basel Week. The work he was showing was, to my astonishment, one reflecting on a statement Carlos Alfonso had written. I was smitten, but the work was far too ephemeral for me. I have since become a big supporter and have acquired his work, including recently this wall piece. Seen here in the foreground, having a generational conversation with Alfonso's figurat in the background. Collectors Herbert and Dorothy Vogel diligently assembled work by artists reflecting their time, an effort done with the constraining salaries of a postal worker and a librarian. Their accomplishment, their mythical success, clearly showed me that a limited income was not a barrier to collecting. Admiringly, I would often see them hanging out at 420 West Broadway on Saturday afternoons. My small collection, I like to think, reflects their spirit. Let me close by sharing a memory relating to Gonzalez Torres and his 1995 retrospective at the Guggenheim Museum in New York. Seeing his art so completely presented was of great satisfaction, but more so was heading out onto the Manhattan streets and seeing hundreds of people walking around town, clutching a rolled piece of paper in their hands. The artist's offering, a beautiful, profound revelation, an unforgettable memory. Thank you.
Okay, we had the fortune to listen to very distinct, four very different voices and contributions really to the collecting and the marketing of contemporary Cuban art here in Miami. And now we have an open forum. Are there any questions? Yes.
Yes, I would like to know what is the appeal of an artist like Damien Hirst when you compare it with these artists? I mean, why is such a disparity in, you know, his value as an artist, and then you have people who are very artistic, very creative. What is it?
Anybody would like to take that one?
You don't like Damien Hirst?
I'll
tell you, I won't answer that part, no offense, but for many years in the old Museum of Modern Art, when you walked in, on one side was a very, very large Jackson Pollock painting, and on the other side was a Wilfredo Lam painting. The Wilfredo Lam painting had to be worth 1/1,000th the price of the Pollock. Forget about Damien Hirst.
Yes. Well, the young British artists had the good fortune of finding a great gallerist, Saatchi. And that made a lot of difference. We all know that there are great artists out there that just simply are not recognized in their lifetimes. We can talk of many cases of the impressionists and post-impressionists and artists that went through life and nobody saw them for what they were worth. And I think that Saatchi had a lot to do with the success of the young British artists, and Damien Hirst certainly.
I think it's all personal taste as well. Some people really like the Damien Hirst works and some people don't.
Well, you got pretty good answers there. Yes, they're going to give you a microphone.
Thank you very much for sharing your personal stories. I am the director of the Bermuda National Gallery, also very much interested in the wider Caribbean region. And I'd like to ask the panel, what do you think your thoughts might be on a Mid-Atlantic art fair, a fair specific to the Caribbean archipelago, if we want to stretch the Caribbean story all the way from, say, Suriname to the Azores? Do you think that that might formulate an important element in the dialogue that was referenced earlier in terms of the model to develop commercialism, representation, awareness, value?
Do you know how many art fairs there are?
Right.
I don't know. I mean, I think something, a biennale, something maybe, but we are in a moment with an explosion of art fairs to a point of nauseam. So for me, I don't think art fair is the right solution.
Well, I do believe that there is such a thing as a Caribbean art cultural reality. The historical connects of slavery, the various countries, just a few, that colonized the Caribbean, the movements of people back and forth. The Caribbean was an area of great movement and visitors coming and going. There was a great show about art in the Caribbean here at the PAMM Museum.
Yeah.
And it was an eye-opener because we saw the connection of various different islands and countries that, are connect with the Caribbean. And it was evident, it was clear that there is a commonality of culture. So I would hope that we see more activities focused on the Caribbean and its art. I don't know if a fair or more exhibitions, museum shows, hopefully a gallery that concentrates on art of the Caribbean, focuses that.
Yes. Yes, Elizabeth?
The question is, who is buying Cuban art
Mr.
today?
Mr. Farber is buying Cuban art today.
He's the poster child.
Thank you.
In Miami. What has the collecting... I mean, well, you've painted a very clear picture.
I can tell you that 70% of the sales in our gallery go to non-Cuban Americans. North Americans, Europeans who visit. It's becoming an international crowd. It is no longer... the reign of the Cuban and the Cuban-Americans.
How would you compare that collecting with the collecting that was taking place here very rigorously in the 90s?
Like, totally, totally different, of course, yes. It was the complete opposite.
The art market is so tremendous now that Cuban art still hasn't found its place. I know that I always see Ramón at the auction sales in New York. And there really is very few great works that come up at auction of Cuban contemporary. I mean, there's better works of the vanguardia occasionally that'll come up. But Cuban contemporary, if you go to Sotheby's, Christie's, and Phillips, you will find a lot of them. Phillips is trying hard, I know that. But with the others, when you go look at a Bedia, for example, it's the worst Bedia that you've ever seen. And it's hidden in the back. You can't find it when you're walking through. They don't get it yet. And I think the biggest thing that would help Cuban art, whether it's older Cuban art or contemporary, is awareness. And the auction houses that have the clients should be doing more.
I'm sorry, I have one more question for you, Mr. Farber. Do you think that the galleries play an important, from the collector's perspective, that galleries play an important role in that market?
Absolutely. First of all, as a collector, I will... It's an image-driven business. As you said, if you have the art, it will sell. So, yes.
Yes.
I think this is for Mr. Farber. And my question was curious. When you were talking and you said about having galleries, maybe I'm wrong, but I think it was you, having galleries in Cuba and having, which I'm totally for the idea of private business. That's not where the question. But the first thing that popped into my mind was, what would David Swerner look like in Cuba? What would that be like, you know?
Sorry, I'm...
David Swerner Gallery, do you know?
David Swerner?
Yeah. Well, what would that be? Like, is that... Like, is that what we're thinking? Is that the idea? Well, you know, I'm like, couldn't help but wonder, what would Sean Kelly, who I was in a talk with last night in New York, if he would open up in Cuba, that, what would that be like? And is that the idea, or what the idea was, to have other kinds of galleries, or was it really to promote independent Cuban gallery? And is there any way that that could really be controlled? So I may have like a total of three questions there.
I have a feeling that many of the big galleries want to open in Cuba, not for the reasons that we would like. We would like them to have more Cuban artists being represented, but I think what they want to do is put their whole roster of artists who are international in their gallery in Havana.
David Swerner just put a major show of Cuban concrete art,
right.
A very successful exhibition that gave enormous publicity to that sector of artists from the 50s and helped not only divulge their work but raise their prices. I'm not only talking of the top international galleries. I think that what we really need in Cuba are hundreds of galleries. We have over 150 galleries in Miami alone. 80% of these galleries are 3 years old or more. So they've stabilized. And they reach all kinds of art, and they reach all kinds of collectors and pockets. And this is what we need in Cuba. For the emerging artist who wants to sell his or her works for $50, $100, hopefully some of these smaller galleries will help reignite art collecting inside Cuba by Cubans, something that is also needed for the Cuban arts to flourish.
Okay.
I've never been to Cuba, all right? So all I get is what I hear all the time. And one of the things that everybody says to me that knows about Cuba is they always tell me that money is difficult in Cuba. And one of the hardest things, if we think of Miami prior to 1990, you know, money was difficult in Miami, and the arts have developed the minute that money comes down here. And the concept of having, you know, the Lesters with Miami, but also with Basel coming and bringing everybody from around the world, it's like the market has increased. You know, I go back to 1980, 1990, this place was difficult. It was hard to sell a piece of art. Now all at once, Wynwood is completely developed and the money seems to be coming. But the comment that comes to me all the time is that if you take your art to Cuba, you're not gonna sell anything. Now, can you react to that?
If you take your art to Cuba, you won't sell anything. Are you talking about from the average Cuban to buy and collect?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
But
that...
It's hard to sell art in Miami.
Yeah.
No?
Well, you have to start somewhere, and the idea here that I think Ramón Cernuda put forward is that you start from the very bottom, and you start with selling at, you know, low prices that a growing class of people in Cuba with money, because it's not like there is no money in Cuba at all. If you need to travel over there and look around to see that there is a growing, it's a very small part of the population, but a small part of the population nevertheless is coming into businesses, private businesses. Yes. And there's some money floating around, and I imagine it can only increase. But I like to make a comment myself, since I have a microphone in front of me. You know, what we have seen in Miami, well, first of all, we're talking about contemporary art. If you go to Miami Homes, collectors, you are amazed at the amount and quality of Cuban contemporary art on the walls. It really is amazing. But that's only half of the story. If you go to other collectors' houses, you see an incredible amount, quality of Cuban modern art, probably more than there is in Cuba right now. So together, if you put that together, 20th century Cuban art is represented in Miami as well as in any city in the world, including Havana. It's just the amount, the quality is mind-boggling, and most people don't even know that it's there. But, and so to me, and this is the result of individuals who have put their love, their effort, their money into this, okay? But what is missing to me in this equation is the public institutions, that they do not exhibit it. They do not put together any comprehensive exhibition of either modern or contemporary Cuban art. We heard of one panelist who has made a number of contributions to this museum. I am sure that if we are now allowed to go into the the warehouse of this museum, we're going to find quite a bit of Cuban art in there. But you never hardly ever see it. You see pretty much always the same belly outside and things like that. And this is not the only one, because it's not the only museum in town. There are other museums in town. And so what I find that we're missing in this town is the public institutional support, really, for the exhibition of all of this art. The only one that really has made an attempt in collecting and exhibiting is the Museum of Art in Fort Lauderdale. And now that the person that was behind it, Jorge Sant, is retired, good luck if you want to see that again. And so I think we need that. I think that's my own, humble opinion, is that that is what's missing in this equation. Okay, the artists are here, the collections are amazing, but who sees them? I mean, I have people who come to Miami, and because I've dealt with Cuban art for a while, by dealt, I mean I taught it and so on, I don't deal with it, but, and they ask me, well, where can we go see a collection of Cuban art? I said, I don't know. There's none. I mean, there's none that is in public view. I would have to call friends to go to their private homes, but that gets all, you know? So it would be nice that people come to Miami and say, well, I mean, you have this community here that, for better or for worse, have been here since the 60s. It's huge. They have all kinds of power, the Cubans here. They are the majors. They are the CEOs of banks. They are all kinds of... But where is a public collection of Cuban art that you can go and look at? Nowhere. I hope it changes. Any other question? Okay. There's one here. Oh, yeah. Okay, the microphone is over there, so yours later.
Hi. Hello, Juan. It's such a pleasure to hear you and all of you. Thank you for your wonderful interventions. Juan, you're being... Professor Emeritus, and having had quite a lot of influence in the world of academia, I'm interested to know your and the other panelists' impressions of the role of academia, even though we're talking about the market. I think certainly in the 80s, Miami-Dade was pivotal in presenting the Marielle artists, etc. What is your opinion of the role of academia, universities, colleges, etc., in promoting all art, but in this case, Cuban art? Thank you.
Well, I guess that's for me. the only concrete things that I can put my finger on is that the Miami-Dade Community College, the Francis Wilson Art Gallery of Miami-Dade Community College, the downtown campus, the Wilson campus, in the 80s, had a very active exhibition of Cuban Americans and artists. Practically every Cuban American artist here in Miami that today has a name had an exhibition there, a one-person show there, due to the efforts of a man named Francis Sheldon Lurie. Sheldon Lurie was a dynamo, and he had, and many artists began their career there with catalogs and everything else. And there were lectures, and it was very, very dynamic, okay? The Marielle generation, too, had their doors open there. Sheldon had an untimely death, and so he could not be there to support the artists that came in the 90s because he was gone by then. But I'm sure he would also have been a major place, a kind of an alternative space for this. So... that is one concrete example that I can put. Beyond that, in my own, sort of a small effort, I taught a class for almost 20 years in the history of Cuban art at the university. And it was a great success. It was always full, 60, 70 students, 50, and people took it from all walks of life. I mean, it wasn't just Cuban Americans, although they were probably the majority who took it to impress her parents with some knowledge of Cuban culture. But you had I mean, American Indians, African Americans, whatever. It was a huge variety of people. And I think that academia could do more as far as teaching, as far as what I try to do in my classes, most classes in the United States are of European art, American art. And one of the things that I try to do, and I'm sure a colleague of mine, for example, Carol Demian and others, what they did was to include Cuban and Latin American artists in their classes of art, whatever art it was, find an excuse to put them in there along with the others. Because just like Fred was speaking, you know, like you go to the Museum of Modern Art and it's great to see a Pollock and this here with Fred Olam. That's the context that it should be. It should be in the context of international art. It shouldn't be totally ghetto-sized. So these are, I mean, I also see that at places like CIFO, which is a museum, Cernuda and his gallery, and so on, Howard with his internet magazine is doing a great job of educating people, because education is very important. You have to educate people, and you have to give them the information. Otherwise, what you don't know, you don't see, you know? So it's a great effort. That magazine is a great, great effort. And also, since I'm weird about this, please think very seriously about giving that next award in Miami. That would be a real good thing to do. Okay, somebody else had a question here. Yes, there. It's over here. Somehow they don't see you to bring you the microphone.
Buenas tardes. En español, lo siento.
That's okay.
A mí me gustaría saber, con relación a la circunstancia concreta de Cuba y los artistas que producen en Cuba, que normalmente son los que se autogestionan la venta, o sea, la comunicación con los coleccionistas y las galerías en el exterior. Si esa situación a ustedes como coleccionistas les resulta cómodo, si es favorable, también teniendo en cuenta que los coloca como los primeros mediadores entre esa producción que se hace en la isla y, bueno, el gran contexto mundial.
Bueno, yo pienso que ante una situación como la que se da en Cuba no hay muchas alternativas. Quien realiza la obra a veces se ve también obligado a venderla. Siempre, en mi opinión, es mucho más saludable cuando el creador no participa del proceso de comercialización. Esa gestión es una gestión que puede y a menudo interfiere en el proceso creativo posterior. Yo pienso que los creadores de Cuba libraron batallas importantes en la década de los 80 y a principios de los 90 y lograron ser los primeros o de los primeros cuentapropistas que hubo en Cuba. Dieron las batallas para que se les reconociera la categoría de trabajadores por cuenta propia, dieron la batalla para que se les permitiera vender sus obras directamente sin que fuese a través del Fondo de Bienes Culturales o de otras entidades gubernamentales y que pudieran además percibir el pago de esas obras en divisas. En aquella época eso fue un gran logro y fue un logro producto de luchas y de discusiones. Yo pienso que de igual manera hoy los artistas pueden lograr que el Estado reconozca que es necesario privatizar el proceso de la comercialización del arte. Si después que eso esté dado, si después que existan cientos de galerías, alguien quiere de todos modos vender su pintura de manera directa, bueno, ese es su derecho. Pero realmente, además, los coleccionistas mucho más respetan a aquellos artistas que trabajan a través de galerías, porque los coleccionistas avisados saben que la institución galería es la que le va a brindar a ese artista un futuro, una promoción y una futura valorización.
Okay. So it's this person wants to ask a question a long time. Can you please give him a microphone? Yes, please.
This question is for Ramón and for Fred. I am a real estate broker, and my profession takes me into many very expensive homes. And over the years, it has all, over the past three decades or so, it has always impressed me that I go into many of these homes and there is no art whatsoever. Sometimes there is a print here, a print there, or they have something that is commercial from Miami Beach artist or something like that. And they say, come and see what I have. I have, and then they name the artist. And I wonder, what can you do to make or to push the collectors or people who have the asset, the money, to buy and invest more in art and promote art collecting in Miami? Because you go to New York, for example, and you see somebody that has a $2 million apartment, and perhaps inside the apartment you see $10, $15 million worth of art. Here in Miami, you may have a $5, $10 million home, and inside what you see is probably worth $2,000. I mean, that's an exaggeration. But what can you do as gallerists, if anything, to promote art collecting in Miami?
If I may interrupt for a minute, I think that the challenge is to get the people that own those houses and apartments to give money to the museums, because they don't. Sorry, gallerists.
I'm going to give you my card. We can work something out. 38 years. This will be my 38th year. And that conversation and that question, along with the academic question of this traditionally has not been a place that attracts scholars. Nobody moves here for the scholarly climate of Miami. They want a boat, they want a big house. Those people don't typically show much interest, support museums, support not just Cuban academia, but all sorts of art historical academia, and they don't buy good art, forgive me. So I don't know, quite honestly, at this point, what supports my gallery and what supports my artists is from outside of here. It's less and less every year from here. And sadly for me, the better my exhibitions get, the less chance I have of selling it in this audience. It's not a, I love you, but this is my reality, and maybe it's just my warped position. But I think the question that you ask is a question for our community. It's a question for this museum. I think the charge, I would love to educate the community, but I don't get grants, I don't get funding. The only thing I get is what I sell. All of the institutions here, the schools, it's their charge, it's their responsibility to educate this audience, to demand a level of quality. We have 80 some, 150 galleries here. The quality of those galleries, in my mind, is questionable. It's not enough just to have lots of galleries. We have to have good galleries. It's not enough to have a lot of artists. We have to have good, serious artists. So it is a question that's much bigger for me than my gallery, and it's a question that I can't possibly deal with other than to put it back on much bigger institutions. But I will give you my card.
Is the glass half full or half empty? When you see a home with great walls and no paintings, is it an opportunity or is it a shame? We see it as an opportunity, and we love not only to sell paintings, but to help build collections. And this is a young community. We've all talked about Miami 20 years ago, 30 years ago, small town. Someone said that it was virtually impossible to place a painting. Young people who had arrived to this country with nothing, and they've built their lives and built their economies. I remember when you were a teacher. You were not collecting then, were you? And you are collecting now, seriously, very, very seriously. So it takes time. Wealth has been built throughout these years. And I think that people are growing and they're also opening up to the arts. I have a positive view of the community, their interest in the arts. It's growing. I think the museums are playing a role and they should even do much more. But it's also up to all of us.
Yep. Okay. Thank you, guys. And thank the panelists, please.
Terrific, thank you.